Hey Mark, so what do you want to build next? What is this? Come on, Google, give me some answers. How to iterate through two lists in parallel. Yes.
Hey fam, welcome back. If you've ever wondered what software engineers do, then this video is for you. Before I started working full-time as a software engineer, I thought I had a pretty good idea of what engineers did. I knew they wrote code to build technology like mobile apps, websites and services, and had a couple of team meetings, but that's about it. I thought that for most of my days, I would just be coding up new features, but software engineering is much more than just coding. Looking back, I realized that I didn't really know much about what went on in the daily work life of a software engineer. So that is what I'm here to shed light on. This is information that I wish my younger self would have known. Before we move on, I'd like to welcome those who are new to our channel. My name is Itzel, and I am a senior software engineer at Pandora. In this channel, Dante and I share practical advice and knowledge to help you enter and thrive in the tech industry. This video will provide you with a high-level overview of what the workflow for software engineers looks like. Let's jump right in. As a full-time software engineer, you will have to attend multiple meetings. An important meeting that begins the software development lifecycle is a project kickoff meeting. During these meetings, the product manager will review the product requirements document, also known as a PRD, which outlines the new features to build for a project that your team will be working on. If you're not familiar with what a PRD is, I highly encourage you to check out the video linked above where Dante explains what a PRD is. Soon after the project kickoff meeting, your manager will create tickets for features that need to be worked on. And during the sprint planning meeting, engineers will be assigned a ticket. So now, let's pretend that you just finished attending a sprint planning meeting and you have been assigned a feature to work on. You will be adding the subscribe button to YouTube. So what comes next? The next phase in the life cycle is to do research. Engineers are always doing some type of research. Some teams will create research tickets to keep track of the research findings, which are also known as spikes. The research tickets are meant to give engineers time to determine how much work will be required to implement a feature or fix an issue and how long that will take. Here are some things that I do as part of the research phase. I carefully read the user story that I'm working on, which is a description of the feature that I was assigned, to make sure that I have a clear understanding of how the feature should work. I ask clarifying questions to my product manager if I come up with cases that were not outlined in the PRD. I dig into the code base to figure out how to implement my feature to get an idea of what I know versus what I need to learn, and walk through different workflows in the code base to determine how those will be affected by my changes. Researching also includes reading through technical documentation if you're not very familiar with the technology that your team uses, reading through internal wikis to gain more context on your team's product, and reading through Stack Overflow posts. There is a lot of reading that we do on the job, way more than I expected when I was in school. Okay, so now that you have done some research and have an idea of how to implement your feature, you will then have to provide sizing estimations to your manager and product manager so that they know how long it will take for you to build that feature. And estimating is a skill that I learned on the job. Providing estimates on how long it will take to build a feature is not as easy as it sounds. I've personally found this skill challenging to develop, but this is where the research that you did previously really comes in handy, because your findings will help you determine approximately how long a feature should take to build. Estimating features is challenging because you may run into unexpected bugs that you didn't account for in your original estimate, or writing the code logic, refactoring code, and writing tests took longer than expected. Estimating is a skill that every new engineer will have to develop, and is one that I am constantly working on improving. All right, so you've done your research and provided your estimate. Now we get to the fun part, where you start writing code. When you are developing a feature, a big part of it is writing code. But along the way, you may also have to do additional research, reach out to your teammates to brainstorm solutions or help you decide on which approach to take, or reach out to your product manager to get additional details on a missed workflow. As you're developing your feature, you will also have to test your changes to make sure that it works as expected. Once you have finished coding up your feature, testing your changes by writing unit tests or testing manually by walking through workflows, and have verified that your feature has all the capabilities that were outlined in the user story, and then you'll go ahead and create a pull request, which lets other engineers in your team know about the changes that you're making to the code base. If you're not familiar with pull requests, I encourage you to check out the video linked above where I explain what a pull request is. Your team will then review your code changes and give you feedback. Everyone in the team reviews code changes, so you will also have the opportunity to provide feedback on other people's code. In my team, we need at least 2 approvals from our teammates to merge our code. Once your code looks good to go and your code changes are approved, then you can finally merge your feature into your team's code base, which means that your feature is going live and internal teams can start testing it. Eventually, once it gets to the production environment, external users will be able to interact with it. The next phase of the software development lifecycle is the post-launch support. What this means is that once your feature is available for external users, your team will be responsible for maintaining that feature and fix any bugs that users report. Also, the product team may want to add some enhancements to improve the experience for users, so you'll be doing that during the post-launch support. As you can see here, building software products is an iterative process. Once you launch a feature, it doesn't stop there. Your team will be involved in improving the feature until the product team and users are satisfied with the experience. And the cycle will restart as the engineering and product teams think of new features and improvements to make. So now you know what software engineers do to launch a feature, from ideation all the way to execution. And these are some of the most commonly known software engineering responsibilities. But there are other responsibilities that we have as engineers that I wasn't aware of. Throughout the whole software development lifecycle, engineers have to maintain constant communication with our manager, our team, and our product manager. One way we do this is through stand-up and sprint meetings. In stand-up meetings, engineers go around the room and answer 3 main questions. What did you work on yesterday? What are you working on today? And is there anything that is blocking you from moving forward with your work? The frequency of stand-up meetings will vary per team. They could happen daily or a couple times a week. They can be done virtually via Zoom meetings or via Slack, where you'll write your status at a set time or when we were back in the office as an in-person meeting. In my team, we have stand-up meetings twice a week, Monday and Wednesdays, via Zoom. The purpose of stand-up meetings is to share the progress of your work, ask for help if there are any blockers that are preventing you from moving forward, and share knowledge with the team. And then we have sprint meetings. In sprint meetings, you get the opportunity to share status updates with the product team about the features that you are working on. But the communication between your team, manager, and product manager isn't confined to these meetings. I keep constant communication with my product manager and reach out whenever I have questions about requirements and need clarity to move forward with my work, when my changes have gone live, and to follow up with how the rollout of the feature went. Similarly, my product manager will reach out to me if there are any bugs with the feature or improvements that we need to make to get an update on whether we are on track for the launch dates or to get clarity on how the feature is being implemented. Also, to build rapport with my teammates, I'll set up weekly check-ins or virtual lunches to see how they're doing. When I am working on a part of the code base that someone else worked on previously and need additional context, I'll reach out to that specific teammate. You'll also have weekly one-on-one meetings with your manager where you can raise concerns, update them about how work is going, discuss your career path, or even talk about your dogs. But this definitely shouldn't be the only time when you communicate with your manager. Ideally, you should feel comfortable enough to reach out to them whenever you need their support. Another responsibility that we have as engineers is to provide feedback. As engineers, we have multiple opportunities to provide feedback. We provide feedback for our teammates and managers through yearly performance reviews on what they've done well and what are some areas for improvement. And we get the opportunity to provide feedback for the product team, the quality assurance engineering team, designers, developers, and our manager during retrospective meetings. Retrospective meetings, also known as retros, happen after a project has been completed. The purpose of these meetings is for everyone to voice their opinions about what worked well and didn't work well during the development process. How often you have retros will vary from team to team. These can happen after every sprint or after every product launch. In my team, we have retros after every sprint, which means every 2 weeks. The last responsibility that we have as engineers is to write documentation. Writing documentation helps share your knowledge with the rest of the team and make it easier for future developers to understand the code you have written. You can write documentation before or after you build a feature, but it is recommended that you do this throughout the software development lifecycle so that you don't forget to write important information about the changes you made. Some of the goals of writing documentation are to share knowledge about how a feature is supposed to work, provide context on what technologies were used to implement that feature, how it was designed and why those decisions were made, and to write down important business logic that is not commonly known and that future engineers should be aware of if they ever have to make enhancements to your feature. Now that you know about some of the responsibilities that we have as software engineers, I'd love to hear what is one thing you learned from this video. So please let us know in the comments below. As you can see, software engineering is more than just coding. It involves constant communication and collaboration with the product teams to get features out the door. This has been my experience, but every company has its own version of the software development lifecycle. If you're an engineer, I'd love to hear what your software development workflow looks like. If you found this video helpful, please give it a thumbs up, subscribe, and share with someone whom you think can benefit from it. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you in our next video.